biology.
So very much welcome to this class, whereby in this class we are going to discuss about the blood groups, whereby you see that the red blood cells have a protein called antigen in their surface. The antigen determines the blood group, the specific blood group of a person. So the blood with antigen A is classified as blood group A. The blood with antigen B is classified as blood group B, whereby the blood group AB has both A and B antigens. However, we see that blood group O does not have any antigen. So the plasma also has protein which are called the antibodies designated as small a and small b. The function of these antibodies is to defend the body from harmful microorganisms. So far from that, let's now look at blood transfusion. So what is blood transfusion? So we see that a person with blood group A has antibody small b, and a person with blood group B has antibody small a. So the person having the blood group O does not, has both small a and small b antibodies. And before we proceed to blood transfusion, first of all, let's look at definition of terms, whereby let's first of all define who is a donor and who is a recipient. So a donor, this is the person who gives blood to the recipient, whereby a recipient, this is the person receiving blood from the donor. And as you can see in this diagram of blood transfusion, we see that blood group AB has neither small a or small b antibodies. And by this reason, therefore, it is referred to as universal recipient, meaning that it can receive blood from all other blood groups. So it can receive blood from either blood group A or blood group B, since it does not have any antibodies, whereby the antibodies, you say that they can cause clumping together of blood, which is referred to as agglutination. So what is agglutination? What's the definition of agglutination? We see that this is the clumping together of the red blood cells due to the antigen of the donor binding together with the antigen, with the antibody rather, of the recipient. So if the blood group of the recipient will bind together with the blood group of the donor, so the cells will therefore come together, and it will be pictured like it's like they have been applied glue. So they are going to stick together. So this sticking together of the red blood cells after blood transfusion is referred to as agglutination. So again, you see that blood group O is referred to as the universal donor and can donate blood to all other blood groups. This is because they do not have any antigen, either antigen A or antigen B, that may cause agglutination. So let's look at the principles or the rules of blood transfusion. So what are the rules or the principles of blood transfusion? So first of all, we see that the donor must be a healthy person, so they must be healthy. Also, for the donor, they must be between 18 to 65 years of age. And then again, we'll say that they must not have donated blood in the last 6 months. So far from that, let's look at how blood transfusion is done. So we see that 0.5 liter of the donor's blood is taken from the vein in the arm and placed in a very clean plastic bag, which mainly contains an anticoagulant to prevent blood clotting or agglutination. So the donated blood is kept in a blood bank at temperatures just above the freezing point for less than a month, because if a month passes, we'll see that most of the red blood cells would have died, and therefore if you transfuse this old blood to the recipient, it won't be that much effective because most of the red blood cells would have died. So the blood should also be screened for different pathogens. Example, we have the pathogens for HIV, we have the pathogens for tuberculosis, and many other pathogens. So the blood must be screened before being donated or being received by the recipient. Also, we see that blood typing should be done for the blood group ABO and the rhesus compatibility determined. But what is blood typing? So blood typing, this is the determination of the correct antigen or the antibodies or the rhesus factor in the blood before transfusion or before donating of the blood by the donor. So since we have mentioned the rhesus factor, now let's look at the rhesus factor. So what is the rhesus factor? So you see that the rhesus factor, this is another antigen in the blood, in the red blood cells rather, apart from the A and B that we have just discussed. So this is another additional antigen. So it is called the rhesus antigen, or it may be called the antigen type D. So if in an exam you have been asked to define the antigen type D, you are going to define it exactly the same way you will define the rhesus, whereby you see that the rhesus, this is another antigen in the red blood cells apart from the normal A and B. So again, you see that the individuals having the rhesus factor are said to be rhesus positive, and those without the rhesus factor are said to be rhesus negative. So we should also know that the blood plasma has no antibodies for the rhesus factor, but can it can surely develop the antibodies for the rhesus factor gradually or with time. So with this example, this is a very common example which is mainly given in many places for the rhesus, because it is the main example to illustrate the rhesus, whereby we see that if a rhesus negative woman is married to a rhesus positive man, all the children they are going to have will be rhesus positive. Let's look at this example. The firstborn here will have no problem after giving birth, so they will develop no problem during pregnancy, not during pregnancy, but when they were in the womb being the fetus and in the lifeline, so they will have no problem. But in the pregnancy of their mother, if the blood passes, if their blood however passed into the mother's bloodstream through the placenta, the mother's blood would surely respond by producing antibodies against the blood of the fetus. So the first pregnancy will prevail, will proceed to completion, whereby a child will be born, or the mother will give birth to a healthy firstborn. But if during the second pregnancy the fetus blood leaks to the mother's blood, so the mother, the antibodies of the mother will cause destruction of the fetus red blood cells, because it's like they will have detected that there is a foreign material or there is a harmful microorganism in their circulatory system, whereby it will only be the blood system of the fetus. So the fetus, however, after destruction of its red blood cells by the mother cells, so the fetus will develop a condition which is referred to as erythroblastosis fetalis, or it might be called hemolytic disease of the newborn. So how will you know that the baby or your baby is suffering from this disease or has been affected? So you see that the affected babies have mainly yellow skin and may develop a condition which is referred to as jaundice. So they may develop this condition called the jaundice, and they may show also signs of having some yellow skin. So this condition, it might be fatal, but it's not fatal, but it might be fatal. So jaundice is an indication that the child red blood cells have been destroyed. Hence, this child might suffer from anemia, or the child might be anemic. So this condition can be prevented by the administration of rhesus immunoglobulin to the pregnant mother. Therefore, it is very important for pregnant mothers always to visit the clinic from the first week of pregnancy up to the last week of pregnancy. So also, it should be administered to this pregnant mother on the 28th week of pregnancy, or within a few weeks after delivery. So the mother should be given this this disease, or not, the mother should be given this treatment. So finally, we see that the rhesus negative mother can be given injection against the rhesus antibody reaction before she develops, or before conceiving. So this prevents her blood from developing different antibodies when exposed to the rhesus antigen, different rhesus antigen of maybe the fetus. So now let's meet on the next class as we now look on immunity. Biology.